Well, welcome to the second to last panel. It's my great pleasure to introduce the moderator, who happens to be my older brother, Ed. Ed is an Academy Award winning producer. He produced the film The Silence of the Lambs, which is to date the third most recent film to sweep the five main categories of the Academy Awards, including Best Actor, Actress, Best Adapted Screenplay, Best Director, and Best Picture. He's also been involved in producing Fast Food Nation adaptation in Philadelphia. Ed is a graduate of USC's Peter Stark Producing Program. I wanted Ed to be on the panel because he's not only whip smart, but he'll offer us a unique perspective on how to design products with values for consumers, what are essential elements and risks in producing new material, and to make sure it has some emotional resonance for patients so it sticks and produces the best engagement and outcomes. So welcome, Ed.
Thanks, sister. As you can imagine, I'm a very proud brother today. I was here at the previous body computing conference, was proud then, and it's pretty astounding to see what's happened in the last year, just from my lay perspective with an entertainment slant. I was thinking on the way down here today about Leslie's interest in the subject, and remembered going to Ben Franklin in St. Louis and buying a joy buzzer for the young people. It's something you wear inside your hand with a little button, and you get a little shock when you shake people's hand. And I remember shaking Leslie's hand and her getting a kick out of it and immediately taking it out and doing a trial with that electrical device. So I think that's where it all started. We wouldn't be here today if it weren't for Ben Franklin's joy buzzer aisle. Before I introduce this very distinguished group of folks and we start our conversation, the other thing that has struck me in participating here today is just what a radical transformation in medical care we are on the verge of. It seems that since people who knew or were meant to know more about our bodies, since people got sick and went to someone and said, hey, can you help me, it has seemed to have been a top-down model. There wasn't a lot of difference, and even in my life isn't as much of a difference as I might hope between taking a dog to the vet and going to a doctor yourself, in that you go and are probed and are then told what to do, or they do something to you. And we're now moving towards a radically transformational model where we share in our own decisions about our care in a much more informed way, and directly can bypass at times needing care because we know what's going on. This has happened in my business. The media business has been a top-down business. Turn on the radio and you'll hear what's on the radio. People come, I mostly make theatrical movies, and people come and they don't get to re-edit the movies until they get home and get on YouTube. But they re-edit it, and with hip-hop music came out of this movement of remixing and people having access to the means of and information, and the visual media business has changed and will change even more dramatically because people have access. And I'm fascinated to explore here what happens when you give people access to the materials that they're vitally concerned with, whether those be creative or, in this case, as basic as people's own health and well-being and the health and well-being of people who they love. And we've got a really fabulous panel to talk about where that is now and where it might be going. I'll start immediately to my right with Jim Mault. Jim is director of the Health Solutions Group at Microsoft, but is also a trained cardiothoracic surgeon, has done heart transplants, is that right, Jim? And is involved now in with Microsoft in projects that are taking, among other things, and Jim will talk about this, taking medical records and putting them, making them available to people and helping people connect with both their own medical history and other people's medical histories in interesting, people who they care about histories in interesting ways. Maja Mataric is the director of the Center for Robotics and Embedded Systems here at USC. And Maya's an expert in robots and in how robots can relate to people who need healthcare. And her her students won the Body Computing Slam last night. It was a great presentation. Garry Neil's the Vice President at the Corporate Office of Science and Technology at a company you've heard of, Johnson & Johnson. And when I asked Garry what, how to describe what he does there, he said, I'm one of the people looking at the kind of the white space out there. So he's a person who's really involved in how you, in where Johnson & Johnson is going to invest their money and what's going to be exciting in terms of what happens next. You know, the white space that gets filled in at conferences like this. Finally, Tucker Viemeister, a friend, is an industrial designer, works at the Rockwell Group now. Tucker was involved in and helped in design Good Grips. He's always been involved in people-centric design. Tucker also gets involved into questions that may seem theoretical, like what is shopping? And tries to help answer those for companies around the world, and is especially concerned these days, and is here, I think, in part because he's concerned with and developing how people will relate to their medical devices. So I'd love to start, again, just going down through the panel. Starting with you, Jim, if you could, and just if you could talk a little bit with an emphasis towards how people will relate and the audience, but about the work that you're doing, and bring us up to the minute on what you're working on.
Great, thank you. Well, I think, and I'll apologize in advance, if you'll indulge me, I'm going to put all of you to work for a moment just to hopefully make a point. So, what I'd like everyone to do is to raise your hand and keep it in the air if you or someone you know owns a credit card. Keep it in the air, okay. Now, keep it in the air if you're aware of the fact that you can go online right now as a consumer and see one or more of your recent transactions from that credit card. Okay. Most people know you can do that. Okay. Now, keep your hand in the air.
Leslie, you don't know.
Come on, you gotta help your sister out here. Keep your hand in the air. It's a good exercise. It'll keep you awake after lunch. Keep your hand in the air if you or someone you know has ever had your cholesterol measured or has had an immunization in your life. Okay, good. Keep your hand in the air if you can go online right now and find those results. Okay, I can. One, two, three of us. That's an absurdity. Think about it. From a consumer's point of view, you can go online right now and see your credit card transaction from Starbucks this morning, but you have no idea what your cholesterol is from 2 years ago, unless you have that magical piece of paper that maybe the doctor gave you. Or your children's immunization records, how many moms have had to fill out the forms for school, okay? You have to go and find that. In the minds of the consumer, this is now wrong, and it's time. And if you look at data, one survey after another, there's a nice one that came out from the Commonwealth Foundation just in the last few weeks. 94% of consumers believe strongly, important or very important, that they should be able to have electronic access to their lab results, to be able to communicate with their doctor, that their doctors, God forbid, should be able to share their health information so that one doctor knows what the other one's doing at any particular time. So what I'm referring to is the holy grail of healthcare known as data portability and health information interoperability. And this is really what we've embarked on. It's been something that's been talked about for two decades. And so this goes much beyond just talking about an electronic medical record. An electronic medical record is just one piece of a puzzle that will empower a consumer-centric healthcare system with the ability to have the data where you need it, when you need it, the rest of your life, so that if you show up in an emergency room, again, as a trauma surgeon, I've been there, someone shows up all the time, unconscious after a motor vehicle accident, we have no idea what medicines they're on, we have no idea what allergies they have, and people die unnecessarily in this world every day because we just don't have that information. And that's what it's all about, is essentially creating a vehicle that allows people to aggregate their health information into one place. And then you're going to see the propagation of an entirely new ecosystem of new programs and services. Now that you've got all your information in one place, oh my gosh, now I could, maybe the Mayo Clinic could analyze my glucose measurements and my medication list and the exercises that I'm doing, and for $19 a month, they can render a monthly analysis. Oh, Duke University is offering a similar service. So it's going to empower the consumer with the ability from data collected from various devices, their medication lists, their lab results, to open up the world in healthcare that many of us have never really imagined before. So that's a little vignette.
Okay, thanks. That's what you're after. Maya, can you tell us a little bit about the work that you're doing and how it relates especially to the patient?
Well, so I could do a show of hands and say, you know, how many people feel like they have been neglected and ignored in the healthcare process? And hopefully lots of people would say yes. And I guess the work that we do is to bring the personal touch back into the process of healthcare, whether it's prevention all the way out to the other scary part of it, except without the person and without the touch. So you might wonder what I mean by that. Well, we create intelligent machines, in particular robots, that interact socially with people who need individualized one-on-one care. So this is a model of personalized medicine. People talk about personalized medicine a lot. And this is one component of it that I think people don't really think of yet, but they will increasingly. And the idea is that in great many disorders, I don't know, anything from convalescence to long-term rehabilitation to special needs populations, there's a need for one-on-one care in order to motivate people, monitor them, coach them, and get them to do what they need to do in order to improve or be reintegrated into society or just to survive. And that does not exist in the current system. Let's just take strokes. 750,000 strokes per year. People with good insurance get on average 39 minutes per week of physical therapy. But what you need is several hours per day in order to avoid being permanently disabled. You don't need several hours per day forever and ever, but it has been shown that you can recover from stroke indefinitely long. That early period is not the only time. So who is going to provide this care? And stroke is just one example. There are many, many examples that will get worse, as we all know, with the aging population and with the increase in developmental disorders. And so everywhere in the age spectrum and economic spectrum, it looks kind of scary. And so what we would like to propose is that one kind of measure that would help this care gap is introducing really personalized, friendly, individualized technology. And that's not at all the kinds of robots that you're familiar with yet. So these are the kinds of robots that talk to you, know you personally, recognize you, understand everything from your personality to your current arousal state, whether you're frustrated or whether you're sad right now, and then can provide coaching as needed. And that can be anything from, you know, if you're a stage 3 Alzheimer's patient, just getting you to vocalize at all, versus if you're a child with autism, getting you to practice a social game, which then will generalize to playing with other children. So we're right now, as hopefully you saw from the videos and the work that was presented last night by my students, I'm so proud of them. I didn't know until lunch that they won. Such a mom. But I guess what I'm trying to say is that when people think of robotics, they think of it as, you know, things that assemble cars, things that maybe sequence DNA, whatever. But I would like you to think of WALL-E as a model. So for those who have seen WALL-E, if you haven't, you should. It's a great movie. It doesn't have anything to do with needing to have children to go see it. So, and I'm not paid by Disney. But the point is that there is a room, there's a great space out there for filling this care gap with technologies that are the soft touch, something that's there for you, that recognizes you, that's like a buddy. And it would be really great if it were human care, but we don't have trained, available, affordable human care for that. And we're not likely to have it. And so this is a space that can be filled, and that's what the technology is about.
Okay, so we've got medical records, and then we have a robot that may know your medical history and be able to help you. Garry, you're a doctor, and you are looking at that. I mean, if I were looking at white space, I'd come here, and you probably know a lot about a lot of this, but certainly in the year, my mind's just flipping at the number of things that have moved from a concept to something closer to reality. Can you talk about some of the interesting things you're looking at right now?
Yeah, sure. First of all, thank you, and thank you, Leslie, for inviting me again. And I have to say that in its second year, this conference has already established itself as one of the most unique high-impact conferences in the field. And I go to a lot of conferences, so I know what I'm talking about, so congratulations. J&J is, of course, we describe ourselves as being broadly based in human healthcare. So there's almost no element of human healthcare that we aren't in some way interested in. But we've been around now for over 120 years. And in order to do that, to sustain yourself for that length of time, you have to continue to reinvent your business, and certainly in the process of doing that. And we're trying to dedicate at least a reasonable portion of our resource to looking longer term at important healthcare trends and potential disruptors, and see how we can position ourselves, how we can help to grow this ecosystem in an appropriate way. And looking at that, the disruptors that we look at, we've already talked a lot about today, and we're feeling this revolution right now. But I think we didn't talk a lot about consumerism, but consumerism per se really is about to transform healthcare. And healthcare is maybe the last major industry that has not been effectively transformed by consumerism. And so today, I mentioned this to Leslie earlier, that what does that mean? That means that today, healthcare is probably the last industry where you can get very well paid for delivering bad outcomes and lousy service. And that's about to change. The information technology revolution is certainly a huge disruptor. And there are a lot of elements that have to be overcome in this system now. The inertia in this system to be able to allow us to realize the benefit that is obviously there, and the reasons we have not been able to overcome. In fact, we built huge multi-billion dollar industries around things like privacy, and yet we realize that that's an impediment to what we want to achieve, to trying to deal with the enormous complexity of healthcare delivery and transition it from more of the acute care model to something which is more akin to healthfulness or wellness or maintenance of people who have, who you want to prevent from getting sick or who have more chronic conditions that aren't immediately life-threatening. And that's a big paradigm. But as Drucker said, if you look at any modern healthcare delivery system or complex or academic medical center like this one, these are the most complex human organizations that have ever existed in history. And as one individual institution, now we're talking about a huge ecosystem of healthcare delivery systems, regulatory bodies, manufacturers, and patients themselves. So the complexity is enormous. And in addition to just collecting data from health records, we obviously need to be bringing in, we think, at least a much more of a systems approach, a systems engineering approach, bringing in people that understand some of the complexities inherent in other industries and even natural systems to be able to do this. And so looking at that and looking out 10 years to things we should be investing in now, not the science fiction, but the real science seedlings that we want to invest in, you see things as we see at this conference of convergent technology, smarter technologies that help us use the things that we know work today, as Andy Thompson said in his discussion, but also totally new types of combinations of devices, drugs, diagnostics, implantable intelligence that will get us a lot closer to, and robotics that gets a lot closer to realizing a lot of the benefits that we hope will come. So we're looking at all that. key for our success, and maybe we can leverage to a greater extent than we have in the past our decentralized model, which enables us to be able to make investments external to the company, create new ventures, ultimately help those to grow with a view to potentially internalizing them later on.
Tucker.
Oh, how can I follow all these people?
Why don't you talk a little bit? You've thought about making things friendly to people. Can you talk a little bit just about your, kind of the ethos of the design you try to do and how it relates to what we're up to here?
Well, I realize that all this stuff is really complicated and complex, but being trained as an industrial designer, we focus on the user. So it makes things a lot easier if you have a user, a person that you're trying to solve the problems for. So at Rockwell Group, we which is basically an architectural company, we design all these places, but we design them with a user in mind. So for instance, we were designing the Montefiore Children's Hospital in New York, and we decided, why don't we design this from the children's point of view instead of from the doctor or the maintenance people or anything. So all the pictures and renderings we made of the hospital were from like this high instead of like this high. And we thought about where the parents are going to be while their kids are in the hospital and all those kinds of things. And it seemed like a normal kind of project for Rockwell to do, even though we're mostly famous for designing casinos and hotels and restaurants and stuff. But to me, it seems like the same thing. You're trying to design a place where people can have fun and feel like they know what they're doing and, you know, relax. And so why shouldn't that be the hospital experience? We also have been working with McDonald's, and what's interesting about McDonald's in relationship to you guys is basically they make food that people want to eat, and so but now they realize that it's not really good for you to eat that food, so they're trying, instead of trying to make food that people don't want to eat and try and sell it to them, they're trying to make the food that people like to eat into something that's actually good for them too. So I think that's basically my drive, is to try and make stuff that's good for people, make stuff that's good for people that they want to have. And an example of that is like taking information and making it into something that people can understand. For instance, I went to the doctor and had my cholesterol checked, and he goes, it's a 250. I'm like, oh my God, what? So what's 250? And I thought that if he told me it was dollars, then it would mean something to me. So I think you just have to take the, if he said your cholesterol is $250, I'm like, what? That's way too much. So I think the idea is to take the information and make it into something that means something to people so that they can do something with it.
Right, so utility's important. I'm struck, a lot of the talk and knowing about our country and knowing the economic times that we're in, seeing how busy that my sister is, the doctor who I know is, and maybe we can start with you, Jim. I'm wondering, is there a way, as we think about people out there with aging population, not so much money out there and real decisions to make about how to pay for it, and a world where the haves are getting older and will need more medical care, and kind of globally the have-nots don't have as much access to medical care, as whether this revolution that we're talking about, both in terms of records and body computing, will start to make primary care and preventative care a lot cheaper. I hear that a robot that you buy once is probably cheaper than hiring the same person even at $8 an hour or $5 an hour in some places to work. Can I be interested in where, just in terms of getting care to people, if we might be able to put Leslie in a position where she's not looking for a medical record, and where her expertise gets out to a lot more people than it does. Is there a democratizing cost lowering effect to any of the work that's going on?
I think it's our one of our only saving graces, fortunately. I mean, the good news, the bad news is healthcare is still living in pen and paper. The good news is healthcare is still living in pen and paper, and there's so much upside opportunity for implementing technology and robotics. And if you look closely at both of the current healthcare proposals by our presidential campaigns, you will notice very prominently that both of the campaigns are counting on almost $1 trillion in savings enjoyed by implementing health IT universally through our system. So there are going to be, if you look at the data, 20% of laboratory tests and procedures that are done in the United States are duplicative. Your doctor measured your cholesterol, but you show up and he doesn't have your results. So he orders another one. Those kinds of things immediately, and that's what employer groups are embracing, the kinds of things we're doing right now, right and left, because just those costs are inexcusable. But when you talk about an aging population, and doubling of the baby boomers to 80 million seniors, who 9 of 10 of which have chronic diseases, we need to be able to deliver care to more people with less resources and actually improve outcomes and lower costs all at the same time. And very clearly, health technology, sensors in the home, mobile sensors. But the important thing is, you can do all the sensing you want. If a tree falls in the forest and no one's there to hear it, does it make any sound? So home sensors are only as good as the systems, and we talked about this morning, that they're connected to. And what this is all evolving to is really the value proposition is integrating this information from disparate data systems and sensor systems and robotics into smart systems that can what's called exception management, that based on evidence-based practice guidelines can identify the outliers and bring to the attention of the appropriate level of intervention the needs and resources to that individual. So it doesn't always necessarily require a doctor. There's a study just published in JAMA a few months ago showing that your local pharmacist can manage hypertension very, very successfully through a web-based system where people are monitoring their blood pressure at home, uploading their results to the web, their medication compliance is incorporated, and the pharmacist, in a prospective randomized trial, had a significant statistical reduction in average systolic and diastolic blood pressure over a 3-month period of time. So you're going to see people bringing to bear the appropriate level of resource commensurate with need based on technology systems that identify what are called exceptions.
Right. I'd just like to say also that the whole health is like a system, like that we keep talking about, like the sick patient or whatever, but really it, being healthy is living in a healthy community with healthy people around you. Because for me, the best argument for national health, and Leslie's going to kill me for this, is that it means that the other people that I come in contact are going to be, that they're not going to be sick, you know, because we support everyone. So I think that the point is not a pitch for national health, but is that we have to look at health as a system as well as the technology as a system, because they both are systems.
Maja, so these robots, they look expensive. Are there any that are reasonable now? What's the time frame?
I'm so glad you asked that, because that's the one thing I forgot to mention. So in this country, we have no robotics consumer industry yet, though there is one company that's been highly successful, and that's iRobot. They sell the little Roomba vacuum cleaners, also the scuba floor washers, the deluge gutter cleaners, etc. But no one knows beyond the Roomba.
They have a lawnmower too, don't they?
No, that's not them.
Oh.
But they're with some other lawnmowers. Oh. People are a little afraid of lawnmowers because they do have blades. We're talking health here, no cutting. So the vacuum cleaner, Roomba vacuum cleaner costs under $200. It's manufactured for under $30. It's a NASDAQ company, so you can look all this up. But the important thing is they sold 2 million of them just last year, and there have been no lawsuits. So to do some of the things that we're talking about doing, you basically need to put some sensors on the Roomba and wireless communication, and you can either interface in something that's in people's homes, or for example, with stroke patients, they wear two bracelets, as you saw in the images last night, and now the robot knows what the person is doing. It could be wirelessly transmitted to the caregiver, to the doctor, whomever. But the important thing is the robot is there to do the thing that, as you were mentioning, also is this, the system approach, which is that we can give people a lot of information, but as we all know, psychology and changing human behavior is really hard. So it's very nice to tell someone this is what your cholesterol level is, or this is just how obese you are, but now what? And so the idea here is that with not that much cost, we can introduce something in people's lives that fills the role of, could be, you know, a Jewish nagging mother, could be a friendly sister, could be coach, it depends on the person's personality, mood, whatever. So, you know, what I'm thinking about and what we're working on is getting $200 life robots with additional things in the hundreds of dollars range, so very affordable. But there is a major impediment, and that is that in this country, companies are not realizing that this is a killer app, that health is a killer app. Because people think of high-risk things like, oh, the robot can hurt the person. Not if it's small and light and cheap. Of course, if you're talking about a giant robot that, you know, that you strap on and moves your body around or tries to get you out of bed, that's a different thing. That's very hard. And I know there's a great deal of interest in, for example, robotic technology that will get people out of bed, get them to do the toiletry. Because that's the, that is the major break in aging in place. When you can no longer get out of bed and go to the bathroom, then you have to go to nursing home. And you know, it's a big problem, big cost, onset of depression, shortened lifespan. So that isn't what we're talking about, though. We would be talking about motivating the person to get out of bed, but we could not physically help them. And that's a very important difference, because the engineering is not ready, really, yet to touch you and physically manipulate you. But maybe it is ready to help you manipulate your lifestyle in terms of wellness. And that's affordable.
Well, talking about wellness and recovery, I think we've heard about the possibility of people losing weight and different things that help people improve their lives in a wellness area, and that there may be people ready to pay for that. Garry, do you see places where Johnson & Johnson feels like they may create some, that there are investments that are about getting people compliant, about getting themselves well, because they can see more accurately what's happening with the body or because of some body computing type of application?
Yeah, we think there's a huge opportunity there. Since you're, I mean, you can look at things just like obesity and gastric banding, diabetes, for example, so, which is a very simple but robust technology. And there's less than 1% penetration in the marketplace right now, but we've seen in studies that have been published that as many as 75% of patients with type 2 diabetes that are overweight can be off medication completely after gastric banding and very soon. So that tells you that there are potential surgical intervention techniques that can work when you've already reached that state. But what could you do earlier on? And where could you apply technology to help people to do the things that we know will work? You want to prevent diabetes, you have to get people to eat less and exercise more. So what plays are there that help that? We've looked at, there's a number of different technologies out there. You mentioned about the killer app. Well, it's not lost on companies like Nintendo, is it, that are getting through with ReFit, with more consumer-oriented types of applications, which haven't yet really been embraced by the medical profession. But yeah, there's a huge opportunity here. The business models are going to need to change, though, to be able to help us to understand how you can really make a solid business out of that. If you're a provider of products, and more high margin types of products over the years, but I think the revaluing of healthcare, which could be brought about by consumerization, and other types of an entry of other consumer-oriented companies into this space, and all of the constraints that we're likely to see in beginning with this presidential election cycle. I mean, we now are, depending on whose numbers you want to believe, we saw Jim's numbers earlier, which I think I tend to agree with that. I mean, you're at between $2 and $2.5 trillion of spend in this country, which is well over half the healthcare spend of the entire world. It seems to me that it's going to be difficult to go beyond that. So, and the headwinds, the pressure that are going to be coming on us on our profit margins are going to be very, very considerable. So it starts to make some of these other types of business opportunities look more attractive relative to what they've been, as we have to try to find ways to introduce new technology that not only creates value, which we certainly agree, but I don't agree that we'll be able to continue to sustain the types of prices or get the type of reimbursement that we've been used to in the past on margin when we've got this kind of this hard ceiling of reimbursement. So you've got to introduce new technologies which overall reduce the cost of healthcare in order to make them acceptable to the public who are going to be paying for these things, as well as to a larger extent, as well as to the other paying community. And so we are living in a global environment. We have to introduce these same types of technologies around the world, because there are many more diabetic patients in India than there are in the United States. There are many, many more patients with lung cancer and patients with other chronic diseases, atherosclerosis and so on, in China than there are here, larger populations, but the numbers are growing at an alarming rate. So they have the same types of problems we face. By the way, there are so many people that will be getting renal failure due to diabetes in India, where I think there's something like 8,000 dialysis machines in the whole country. So there's just no way to be able to deal with what's expected to be, the last numbers I read, something like 2 million patients with diabetes-related renal failure, unless something else is done. So we have to figure out how to address this, and to what extent can we know that just telling people to eat less or exercise more doesn't work. So what technologies can we apply in these areas? And that's all about the healthness and prevention side of it.
Great. Talking about the world at large, and I'm interested, let me ask for a second. So we've heard a lot about interesting things and interesting technologies, but as a consumer, it's really hard to go online or to find much as relates to health that's outside of Nintendo or Nike that is engaging. You know, that my job in the movie business and people who work in media and make video games are, you know, trying to make engaging visuals, something that's either fun or easily comprehensible, and especially, and this is the revolution of the Wii, something that's shareable. You know, it's a Guitar Hero on the Wii, or experiences that you can share with the other people in the room. Something that cuts against the excellent observation that people are spending a lot less time socializing is the advent of games that help you socialize. And I'm wondering, in terms of especially a company like Microsoft thinking about reaching out to people, to stakeholders in people's health, do you feel like the design of the products that you're doing is that a big impediment, or the designs that you're thinking of and helping people access their records and so on comprehensible? And what are some of the impediments to having things be user-friendly from the patient perspective?
I don't think you could identify a more critical consideration. I think it has to be, we have to find ways to make it fun and engaging. For better or worse, our approach is really to create the foundation, kind of the IT foundation, to allow that data to collect in one place from your pharmacy and from your doctor and so forth, give you an online folder that has all your data. But really what we're spending the majority of our time doing is propagating an ecosystem of domain experts. Organizations like the American Heart Association, the American Diabetes Association, you know, maybe Johnson & Johnson, CVS, Aetna, all of these You know, right now there are about 15,000 different companies and organizations that have what's called the SDK, the Software Development Kit. There's venture capitalists and startup companies that are all building cool new applications and services that are coming to life on this platform. So what we think is the best model is for the marketplace to very quickly iterate, engaging new programs and services, and you'll see winners and losers, just like you did in the internet. And in the early phase of the internet, websites were ugly and dull, and now you've got YouTube and you've got Facebook. So there are going to be the YouTubes and the Facebooks in health information that we think will be powered by this foundational platform of health information interoperability and portability. So we're not trying to be the ones that necessarily, you know, it's better to have 20,000 and 100,000 different companies and programmers all figuring out, like having guys like Tucker say, oh cool, I could build a really cool application that gets people excited about exercising. And that's where I think you're going to see a whole new frontier of opportunity.
I'd like to add to that too. I think, Ed, you're thinking about healthcare as being like hospitals, you know, pharmaceutical websites, stuff like that. But normal people, I think nowadays, think of health and wellness and stuff as being like Equinox, the gym, fun stuff like that, massages, spas, all that stuff is like healthcare, but it's the good side of it, not the the hospital stuff. And I think that's what you're talking to too, about the Microsoft thing, making it like fun and cool, like the apps on an iPhone.
Oh, absolutely. In fact, you'll see apps on iPhone very shortly, and all sorts of platforms, whether it's, you know, the Xbox right now, when my kids play Halo, they're all playing against all their friends everywhere else in the country online. Well, that data can also be health information, and people playing Rock Band online with their health data. I mean,
what are they going to do, play Surgeon with the...
There you go.
Their friends play with the robot scalpel in the other guy's apartment.
So what I think is really cool is the fact that none of us can actually see and appreciate the cool, fun stuff that's going to exist 5 years from now, that just because that health information is able to be in one place for the first time. And it really is, when you put the consumer in a position of power and purchasing power. Just look at the Minute Clinics of the world. Those things have propagated because it was more convenient, more accessible, and if you're pulling $50 out of your pocket for a copay and you go see the pediatrician and you can't get an appointment until tomorrow to get a strep test to figure out whether you can take your kid to school or you have to stay home at work today, or you go to the Minute Clinic because it's right at your fingertips, you can park without having to wait in line, it's happening, and it's irreversible.
So as people have, if I'm just following up there, as people have access to their records, will they then go see their doctor? I can imagine a couple things. One is that people are, will they be able to make their records viewable by other people, if you want people in your family or your doctor to have a look? And will it be suggested that you might join a community? If, for example, you have diabetes, will you suddenly be in a diabetes community?
You just opened up a whole new, you know, entrepreneurial opportunity, and the answer is yes. The key here is by making it possible to get your data into one place. I'll do one more exercise here. Raise your hand in this room if you, as a banking executive, which is kind of a hard thing to be these days, but as a banking executive a few years ago, would have liked to have been the last bank in the neighborhood to offer an online banking service. Raise your hand. That would be a career-ending move, right? So I've been in the boardrooms with all the major retail pharmacies, and literally letting them know about a year ago that we're going to build a place where everybody can collect their medication history. Every one of those boardrooms said, gee, if the other guys are doing this, we don't want our customers walking in the door and saying, how come I can get my medication history electronically from Walgreens, but I can't get it from CVS? They don't want to be in that situation. So we're seeing very quickly, like for instance, this week we announced that Aetna, if you have Aetna for your health plan, as of this week, they announced that you will now be able to get all of your records electronically deposited into your possession in your health vault folder. Guess how many phones were ringing from the other plans that said, wait a minute, if Aetna's doing that, we need to be doing that. How soon can we connect? So it's amazing how quickly the dominoes are going to fall and are falling by putting the consumer in the center of it all. And we're getting calls from about 20 hospitals per day right now, wanting to know if it's possible for them to hook up, just to be able to send a discharge summary to somebody's electronic folder. Because the cool thing is, at the end of the day, every consumer has a legal right to a copy of their health records, don't they? And this is just basically saying, here's the place I want you to send those records, because I already have a right to a copy.
I know for us in the movie business, one of the things they happened is all of our records went on YouTube, and we had to fight hard to get them taken off since we paid for his intellectual property. But the thought is, but people do want things to be seen for rock bands. Suddenly people have a much greater degree of taking that model of how the internet democratizes. They have a much greater degree of control over what they want to have happen and how much they want to interact around any issue. Politics has been transformed by the internet this year, and I guess the same thing's happening with healthcare.
Well, and that does bring up the important issue. We haven't talked about it yet, but it should always come up in this discussion, is the privacy and the data security. And that's paramount as a starting point for all this. But what people have to stop for a moment and recognize is that your data is already out there in electronic form. If you've ever had a prescription filled at a pharmacy, there's an electronic record of that prescription with your name on it. If you've ever been to the doctor's office and your health plan pays the bill, then there's an electronic record of that. So you're already suffering the risk, if you will, of somebody violating your privacy because of your information being out there electronically. The problem is all of that information is walled off and you have no access to it. And so you don't enjoy any of the benefits to that electronic information. And that has to change, and that is what's changing. But you have to put it under the control of the consumer such that no one else can access it without their express permission, and no one can put data into it without their express permission.
Does your system allow for like anonymous data collection? In other words, when everybody's medical records are in this database, it'd be really it seems to me that you could, say, track down epidemics really easily, or things, cancer, you know, clusters or whatever. But and maybe get a more realistic picture of what's going on.
So the answer to that is, we've had Homeland Security and CDC, you know, in our offices saying, gosh, if this is a place where millions of people will be able to aggregate their health information,
we can catch Bin Laden this way.
We what a wonderful way to identify bioterrorism or epidemics of flu. And we say, you know what, that's a great application on this platform, but the answer is explicitly no. Under no circumstances does a single data element, either individually or de-identified aggregate data, it's out of bounds, it's not even open for discussion. We're not monetizing it, and we're not making it available to anyone, including ourselves. But if you, as a loyal American, want to check a box that says, I, as a loyal American, allow my data to be contributed to a database at Homeland Security for bioterrorism, good for you. And that's what this system empowers. is the ability for you to choose to share your data with whomever you want, and to cut off that permission whenever you want as well. So, and so there are, the American Heart Association right now is collecting blood pressure measurements with your permission when you sign up for their program. And they'll graph your blood pressure, they'll create a report that you can take to your doctor. It's all free, but they let you know when you sign up for that program that this program means you're giving them permission to store a copy of your blood pressure measurements for future medical research, and that's great.
So it'll be forensic studies related to all the stuff where people go in and take apart records and figure out how people were like, once people get all their records up online, people get as many of their records up online as they want, to as many people as want to.
Yeah, and you'll be able to, you know, and it does create a whole new social network. You can create a folder for grandma in Florida who doesn't even have a home computer and is never going to, but as long as grandma gives permission for her doctor to send the data here and the pharmacy to send the data, then she can benefit from better coordination of care between all of her caregivers.
And how soon will we all be, you're now working with that. So do you have, what's your guys' timeline? I'd love to go through and kind of talk about what we expect to hear. So expected, you know, to happen here by next year.
Sure. So both ourselves and Google, and it's good that Google's doing this. I know there's, everybody said, what about Google? And it's like, this is good. I mean, because it's showing, you know, two very large IT companies are literally investing hundreds of millions of dollars against this opportunity. More than the government has ever spent, nor probably ever will spend. You know, so it's real and it's irreversible. So it's been live since October of last year, but you haven't seen any full-page ads in USA Today telling you to create your Health Vault account, because we've been spending this past year basically setting up all the connections. So, you know, for it to be compelling for a consumer, you've got to be able to get your medication list. You've got to be able to get your lab results. You've got to be able to connect to your hospital. We've got all the medical device companies, for the most part, the blood pressure meters and the glucose meters, now with plug-and-play connectivity, just like your digital camera. And when you go into CVS or Walgreens in January, you'll see a little logo on the box for the blood pressure meters that says Health Vault compatible, just like you see Windows compatible on your digital camera. So all of that is about building the ecosystem. And so by the first half of next year, you're going to see all the major retail pharmacies. MinuteClinic went live last week, so if you go into MinuteClinic now, they'll say, would you like to get your results into your Health Vault account? And you can say, what's that? And they'll give you a little card and show you how to create your account. So by 2009, you know, mid-2009, you're going to be able to access your health information from lots of different places. It's still going to have gaps. It's just like online banking, you know, 5 years ago, if you went to that bill pay section, they'd say, you know, you could see Comcast and you could see, you know, your electric bill, but they didn't have the cell phones, and you still had to write out a check for the cell phone. But today, they're all there, and you can do auto pay with any of them. So this is a bill that will take probably, we'll see, 3-5 years on the outside. But 5 years, you will look back and you'll say, gosh, remember how stupid it was that I, you know, that I got a piece of paper with the results? Doesn't that seem silly?
And we can open it up if people have some questions. And the microphone will be coming over.
I just wanted to ask if, particularly James, but everybody could speak to the question of the human biome and the, you know, amount of information that will be necessary to log, you know, just the memory necessary, and whether you guys have started to think about that.
Funny enough, we just announced a project with Scripps and genomics. And actually, personal genomics is one of the hundreds of thousands of data types that can be stored in your Health Vault account. It stores both what's called structured as well as unstructured data types. So you can even store your x-rays and your medical power of attorney. But genomics is on there, and scripts, I think it is 10,000? 10,000 patients are going to be able to store their genomics and correlations with all the other data that's aggregating in their Health Vault account.
It's on the bottom.
Could you speak about the amount of data that we need and relative to the rest of the chart?
The question, I don't think the mic's working. So she's asking about the amount of data. And right now, you know, those data sets are fairly limited, but data is very, very cheap. Storage is very, very cheap. And we've spent a few billion dollars in the last couple of years building massive data centers in Texas and in eastern Washington State. And now we've got something to do with those data centers. It's pretty exciting.
Dr. Leslie?
There are two doctors on the panel, and one of the things that struck me in the last year going around and thinking about this, there are a lot of companies that own a lot of really interesting network data. And when I asked the question this morning about who they think their customer is, many of them are very afraid of giving their data to the consumer because they think the doctor's going to get mad. Because their doctor customers and their medical advisory boards and other things tell them that they don't want to liberate the data to the patient. Part of them say that genuinely out of an interest that if somebody learns about breast cancer, reads about stage 3 breast cancer when they have stage 1 breast cancer, there's going to be a lot of angst created if it's not filtered through the doc. On the other hand, it seems to me like it's in some ways we're the lesion, that we're halting progress in the area. And so that the other thing is you can't really develop a business model around any of this until people who own the data feel comfortable.
Advisor or coordinator that also needs to get the data outside of the physician of record for a given problem. But I don't think, again, with the coming wave of consumerism, it's going to be possible to deny them those data. Now, a bigger conundrum, though, is so we can collect a lot of data. We can collect a bunch of health record data, billing data. People can have wearables like you had on this morning, or implantables, now we'll have some great standardized ways to be able to connect those things, talk to the health record, collect all these data. Who's going to do what with those data? Physicians don't want it. That's what they're telling us. The cardiologists are overloaded. They don't want to see 8 weeks of Holter monitoring on somebody. So we also need to develop some sort of systems, algorithms, intelligence that can sort that out and provide a more distilled version that somebody can act upon. Don't you think? And I think that's one of the weak links as we continue to build more and more ways of collecting data. It's also the comparability of these data worry me as well. I think there's no doubt that we're able to in some virtual sense combine all sorts of data. This is happening right now with the Sentinel Network initiative that I mentioned this morning. But how comparable are all these different types of data? How do we know we can make sense of it? And I think that's going to take a little bit longer. So I think those are bigger issues than the one about should the patient have access or a copy to those data, and how do you as a physician, we're all just going to have to figure out how to have those conversations then, which are guided by data that may not be interpretable.
I'll give you two poignant examples. One is actually, and Garry knows about this, is J&J itself. So J&J was at our big splash kickoff launch event for Health Vault on October 4th of last year, and was one of our foundational partners making it possible for the J&J blood glucose meters to be able to upload its data into the Health Vault. And then they stopped and realized, wait a minute, Abbott and Roche and Bayer, they're all going to be able to do the same thing, upload their glucose meter data into Health Vault. So the consumer could use any of the glucose meters and get their data into Health Vault. So where is this all going to go? What J&J very quickly recognized, I think very astutely, is that as the organization that has the cool app that helps you monitor your glucose and gives you advice and guidance, regardless of what meter you're using, is going to be the one that drives all the value and the opportunity and the monetization. Because if it's Bayer that has the cool new app that everybody loves to do, like YouTube, then somehow Bayer might be able to migrate you away from your Abbott meter or your LifeScan meter and over to their meter. And so at the end of the day, I think very importantly, that application logic that Garry is referring to is really where all the domain expertise and all the opportunity is going to exist. He's shaking his head over there from the panel this morning. They were talking about that. But let me give you one other pointed example. I've been in a set of major hospital systems. We have a huge employer group with literally several hundred thousand employees that are going to be implementing Health Vault as a company-wide initiative. In fact, it got implemented for all Microsoft employees a few weeks ago. And so they said, well, our health plan is XYZ, our PBM is ABC, and here are all the hospital systems that deliver care for most of our employees. So we sat down with each of the hospital systems and said, this big employer in your neighborhood is going to start using Health Vault for all of its employees. And the hospital said, well, we don't want to send data to this because the other hospital down the street might steal our patients. And they said, yeah, I mean, that mentality exists. And there are health plans that say, wait a minute, we own this data. We control all this information about this patient. And if we let it go, it's our competitive advantage. That lasted about 10 minutes until I left the room and called the employer and said, would you like to call these guys and let them know directly? And as soon as the employer calls and says, we're doing this, when are you going to send the data to Health Vault? It changed literally instantaneously. So you know, there are early adopters like Aetna. There are health plans out there that somehow think that they can hold out and control the data. But at the end of the day, the consumer is going to, it's just like online banking. There are brokers out there, you know, 10 years ago that said, gosh, people investing online on their own without a broker, you know, that's outrageous. Now every brokerage has an online banking or online trading capability, and that's exactly where it'll be for all the healthcare system, and the consumer will drive it.
I have a question for Dr. Mault.
Yes, hi.
And this is from the patient compliance standpoint. So is it a fair assumption that a compliant patient will be one that is more likely to go into Health Vault or Google Vault or whatever it is to look at to follow up their chronic disease condition? Because eventually I'm hoping that that's one of the applications of Health Vault is for a diabetic patient or a heart failure patient to look into those data every day and then presumably take better care of themselves. Now, if I'm an non-compliant patient, not caring about my daily medication, am I likely to go into your system and look at these data? Let me know if this assumption is wrong, and if it is, then do you have evidence to the contrary?
So, again, this can be used so many different ways. This is a petri dish, but I'll give you some examples. Imagine a large employer who gives the employees a $100 incentive each year to fill out their health risk assessment, which now several employers do. Well, starting in January, that health risk assessment will require them to create a Health Vault account if they want their $100 bonus and fill out the health risk assessment so that data drops down into their Health Vault folder. And then they happen to have a wellness coaching company that has been a contractor to human resources at this organization for many years. Now that wellness coaching company has, you know, by the permission of the patient, of the employee, and again, they're incentivized to participate in the company wellness program, but now this data can come in from their PBM and from their home blood pressure meter, and they can implement their wellness coaching program or diabetes management program much more effectively because they have better information that's all aggregating from these disparate data sources without you necessarily having to do anything as a factory employee other than agreeing to set this up in the first place. So there are just so many different ways that this can be implemented, and at the end of the day, what's required is somebody has to give permission to participate. They have to agree to allow this data to flow to and from the people who are trying to take care of them. But you can have pharmacies and coaches and even your doctor's office, the mere ability for the medication history to show up from the PBM and to be able to share that back to your doctor can make a whole lot of difference.
So I want to applaud you, and I'm over here, sorry.
No,
I think it's great that Microsoft and Google are providing this for free, but you're trying to create a new industry, and you're trying to incentivize 15,000 companies to develop new application. Who is going to pay for all of this? Because I was just at a Health 2.0 conference in San Francisco, and there's no business models that works there.
So that's part of the ecosystem, and that's part of the kind of the experiment that's taking place right now. So even at Health Vault, there are different models of that taking place. If you go to, there's several different personal health records that are in the Health Vault directory now. Some of those are subscription based. You know, one of them's $9 a year for your whole family. One of them's $9 a month. One of them is free, but it's got sponsored ads on it. And over the coming weeks and months and years, the marketplace will dictate what people are willing to pay for or put up with from a sponsored ad point of view, or, you know, maybe I get all this for free if I agree to allow my de-identified data to be aggregated into a database for clinical trials purposes. The sky's the limit. So there's we're not dictating to anyone their particular business model, and there's a lot of opportunity to try different things and see what works. But we need the guys like Tucker to figure out what's cool and engaging that make people want to pay for something or to use it. But that it's kind of a chicken and the egg, because you also have to have all the data sources flowing and connected for it to be useful in the first place.
Jeff? So I'd like Garry to help me out with something, because this dialogue bounces back and forth between two very different paradigms. Most of the time on this panel, it's been a very consumer-oriented paradigm, spontaneous combustion, relatively risk-free, do a platform, do an ecosystem, let 100 flowers bloom, and something will happen. The two prior panels were heavily risk-borne, heavily controlled, very fearful. J&J is in the middle of both, right? You guys live in both of those worlds. Can you give me any middle model which could bring these two together?
Interesting. I mean, first of all, the way we think about risk, the way I think about risk in healthcare is a little bit different, which is really, it's risk, not really benefit risk. It's the risk of not doing an intervention versus the risk of doing the intervention and balancing that out. I think if we think about it that way, even if the regulatory agencies start thinking about it that way, we can, talking about it that way, we can make a little bit more progress. But there clearly is, an engineering component to this, to getting into body computing and drugs and using new technologies to be able to address these unmet needs. And how much safety needs to be engineered into some of these models. We had an example based on our staplers, which are manufactured at Six Sigma and very low failure rates at a particular cost in the U.S. market. That's what's demanded. In China and India, they're saying, we don't want that. We are perfectly willing to accept a 1 or 2% failure rate, but we want a much, much lower price point. Can you provide that? And if you can't, we'll get it from somebody else. And you need to sit down and think about, well, what is the specific risk of a failure in a particular setting, and how much are we going to have to pay to engineer that risk to a more acceptable level, and how will this change on a global scale? We're not able to do that. Somebody else is going to do it in those markets. Yet you still want to, you don't want to produce a product which is shoddy or is going to result in harm. So we need to think these paradigms through very, very carefully. And there are some, you know, the risk equation in some cases. You know, we spend a lot of time talking about implantable defibrillators, that where you may have one set of risk tolerability and you may have something else which is quite different in another setting, building in redundancy. And what the consumers are willing to basically pay for, because again, we're constrained by this triangle of the technology cycle, the unmet need, and the ability to pay. And most of the world right now, we ourselves cannot continue to afford $2.5 trillion a year on healthcare at a growth rate that far exceeds the GDP.
I think that's very helpful. Let me just move it 5 degrees to get just one last thought about this. A number of these things imply a mediated relationship to information, mm-hmm. where the doctor is critical to intervene. A number of other ones imply a disintermediated relationship to the information where the consumer's rights are going to be the driving force. How does Johnson & Johnson, how's the thinking going around where the boundary is between those two? To me, still feel very, very different situations.
They are. I guess it's hard to generalize. You have to look at each individual situation, and so if we play across all of these different worlds, so to speak. But I think the zeitgeist is towards more information going to the patients with more technology that helps them to understand that information or to make something to make it usable for them to be able to intervene. And a little bit more away from the physician who is already overwhelmed. And it was pointed out earlier today that if we continue to rely on physicians to provide all of the care that people need, then we have a huge deficit in physicians. If we think about specialty physicians doing certain types of tasks that nobody else can do, or centers becoming more solutions shops, almost like consulting firms that are creating a diagnosis and a plan, and then leaving that for a much less expensive, easier to use part of the system, which could be even delivered, never mind at a pharmacy, but even in a fire hall or in your own home. If we start to think about that paradigm, then it helps to bring the cost down. I'm personally skeptical, by the way, Jim, that you can get $1 trillion out of the system just by avoiding redundant lab tests.
I couldn't agree with you more.
But you could get $1 trillion or as much as that out of the system by substantially changing. You'd have, or putting it another way, you'd have to substantially change the whole paradigm of delivery.
If you sit down with David Cutler and actually even the other campaign, that they will enumerate a number of hypothetical scenarios that all have to happen, you know, simultaneously for them to realize the $1 trillion savings. So I don't think anybody should hold their breath that Health IT is going to deliver that on its own merit. But I think a lot of the people with their feet on the ground think several hundred billion dollars in potential savings could be
realized. If you had an earmark.
but this is really going to frame the debate that we have as to how are we spending that money and what do we really think we're going to be able to get for it, and when there's a big access problem. So if we continue to have, or if we perpetuate a system which is in some way, giving very disparate access and potentially disparate outcomes because we can't afford to provide that level of care to everybody. I don't think that's sustainable. So how do you provide that reasonable measure of care at an affordable cost and give almost universal access in a profit-oriented system, which we have, which has driven a lot of innovation, and where the incentives, by the way, are very aligned with outcomes. Those outcomes are excellent. They're better here than anywhere else. Where they're not aligned, then the outcomes aren't so good, which we know about. They're comparable to the developing world. So we need to really think about this, and my fear is that the debate won't be comprehensive enough to get at some of those issues. The other part that you mentioned, where we would hope that all of this, you know, building the right infrastructure for collecting data, making the new technology that we have for collecting data inside, outside the body, as well as the effector systems, work, could that help us to reduce this huge impedance mismatch that we have between generation of innovation and the ability to get data in the target species, humans? Because the way we're doing it right now is you know, completely way too expensive. It takes way too long. The devices are already obsolete by the time we were able to get enough data to really show anything close to the amount of safety data that we want to collect in clinical trials. They're already being supplanted by the next generation. And the same thing with pharmaceuticals. So how do we do this better? How do we leverage things like the Sentinel network, which will be built for safety, but can we start to understand how to be able to use that to be able to generate effectiveness data? Can we enroll large numbers of patients using these products in a way that we haven't done today to be able to collect the data to give us that evidence in a way that's rigorous, that makes us comfortable with it, that makes the regulatory agencies comfortable with it, that makes the payers comfortable with it, and says we're really providing something of value that's safe and effective.
I think for this year we're out of time, and look forward to seeing where all of this is next year as the lunatics start to take over the asylum.